Okay, so I really like character action games. I may not be an expert at them, I'm not doing sick combo mad videos or some nerd who's platinumed all of Bayonetta 2, but this is a little genre of games that I genuinely love, and I'm always looking for anything that can give me the same level of cathartic enjoyment that I got out of Devil May Cry 3 when I first played it. However, when you're dealing with an already niche subgenre like character action, indie titles that don't have the marketing teams and spots at E3 like DMC5 or Bayonetta do, inevitably have trouble getting any kind of visibility in the mainstream, and become overlooked because of it. So I'm gonna mix things up a tad and showcase two polar opposites of this type of game that released relatively recently, Assault Spy and Luca Born of a Dream, and see what the indie character action market currently looks like, for the couple hundred of you that are even interested in that sort of thing. Starting with Assault Spy, developed by a tinier Japanese crew titled Wazen, was originally released in early access in May, but the devs have slowly been polishing this game with updates and patches, and officially released the full game earlier this month. For majority of the game, you play as Asura, a corporate spy tasked with investigating a megacorporation, with a second playable character, CIA agent Amelia Smith, unlocked later on into the game. In terms of your setting and story, the game focuses on you committing corporate espionage and spy work, through a way of using briefcases and exploding business cards to smash up security bots based off of common office items like cell phones and Roombas, while trying to stop a terrorist organization that has taken over the company. So essentially, I'm saying the story is mostly just a vague pretense for the specific weapons and enemy designs the game is using, and is the over-the-top schlockfest that is almost expected with the character action style of games, down to the butt-rock background music to go along with it, which is actually pretty good. But disregarding the story's quirkiness and the cutscene animations having a very Unreal Engine mannequin aspect to them, the main attraction everyone is paying admission for with this game is the combat. Starting with our main character, who looks suspiciously like the protagonist of Persona 3, if you're familiar with Devil May Cry, a lot of Asura's playstyle is going to come quite naturally. You have your basic 3-button combo, your combo with the delayed button press on the third hit, your stinger, your high time, a trickster air dash, etc. But as you progress through the game and purchase more moves though, he does start to feel a bit more like his own character, including a flying dropkick and an Azuna drop finisher if you can get behind the enemy's back. Because of the simplicity of the controls, there's a good, easy to master flow to Asura's abilities that even beginners can easily grasp, even attaching his long-range business card attacks to holding down the main attack button. So you can flow from a melee combo right into firing a long-range response as the enemy is sent backwards. Though it feels unnatural at first, so it takes some time to get used to doing that properly. Then there's his Devil Trigger powered-up equivalent, which acts as a sort of manual witch time. God, I can't imagine what this video would be like for someone who isn't familiar with Bayonetta or DMC. Slowing down all surrounding enemies for a limited time once it's activated, leaving them in open season for combos. Though the trade-off is that it oddly speeds up Asura on top of it, which makes the mechanic a tad frustrating to use than if it was just the slowdown effect, since your dash and running is already a tad too slidey for my taste. Never mind putting it into turbo mode. Altogether though, Asura is really fun to play once you start to piece together how his mechanics work with each other, mixing in both short and long range combos on the ground and midair. On the other hand, the second playable character, Amelia, who, if you couldn't tell from the subtle design details, is the American parody of the cast, uses a playstyle that is more focused on strong hand-to-hand combat, and honestly steals the whole show. This might be my penchant for fist-fighting girls speaking, but I actually preferred playing Amelia over Asura, as her playstyle feels more unique over feeling like a modification to Dante in DMC3. Not that I didn't enjoy playing as Asura, But there's something to Amelia's quick dive kick combos and power geysers that is super satisfying to pull off, especially once you unlock the Ebb and Lightning skill. Her mechanics focus on constant offense, as a core ability of hers is building up a meter that strengthens her charge attack, where a little buildup barely can get a reaction out of the enemies, while a full charge has more impact and range, especially if it's upped with her super form that further powers it up into an actual power geyser, which has a gratifying amount of impact to it. In comparison to Asura, who takes a bit of time to flesh out, Amelia feels rewarding almost immediately, and purchasing more skills just adds to it. Though a character action game can only really shine with some strong enemies to fight, and in that aspect, there's a pretty solid cast of basic punching bags to fight an assault spy, which is something even the larger titles of this little genre get wrong at times. From pylons that attempt to hit you with parking garage arms, and segues that constantly reverse away from you in fear, to mecha versions of the enemies that act as mini-bosses. Though the game feels like it leans more heavily toward projectile-based enemies than others like it, so get ready to spend a lot of time dodging around. And I'd be lying if I didn't admit that the flying drones can be a major pain in the ass at times until you learn how to deal with them, since they shoot widespread bullets and usually appear as a group, meaning very little openings to get in and finish them off. But the standout enemies, by a country mile, are the boss characters. Even if you're repeatedly dying, which can happen easily since you have only 5 health pips, these fights are genuinely a lot of fun and are the best moments in the game. No multiple shots coming from different angles, or flying enemies sitting just out of reach, just a pure 1v1 duel where you're dashing around each other, trying to find an opening in their attack pattern so you can peel away their defenses, which has a clear meter that you can read so you know how vulnerable they are. And I hope that's something that catches on. And once their guard is broken, you can just unload on them. That might have been poor phrasing. You get to really put all your mechanics and moves together in satisfying ways with these fights that weaker enemies with smaller health bars don't allow for. And due to the kinetic dashing around to avoid damage and trying to engage with the enemy, feels super close to boss fights like Virgil or the other hunters in Bloodborne, and I don't think I can give a better praise than that. However, all this praise comes with a large 50-inch waist but, and that is that the game is poorly optimized. The framerate stutters at times, especially when a lot of animations are happening at once. The blur effects that accompany said animations and enemy destructions can make seeing what's going on a tad difficult, especially when up close. And along with that, the camera has an occasional habit of misbehaving. Recovery items indefinitely slide across the floor in a manner that doesn't quite look like it was intended, and button prompts quite often don't appear when they're supposed to. So you end up spastically jumping around NPCs like a kid on a sugar rush waiting for them to pop, which can be extremely frustrating. But probably the most undeniable issue with Assault Spy is that it's impossible not to compare it to Devil May Cry 3 or 4, which is a major disservice for it. You can tell the devs at Wazin took a lot of inspiration from DMC and Bayonetta, building on design ideas those games started, but the game lacks a lot of the polish that the bigger titles have, which is significantly more noticeable with these types of games that require finely tuned combat in order to appease the insane fanbase of it. It's understandable that this is an indie title with a smaller team, so there's gonna be some issues, but in its current state, it's still a bit too janky in places to give it a 100% recommendation over older, more AAA games like the DMC HD collections, which costs the same price. Unless you're an addict for this genre and want something new to tide you over while you wait for DMC 5. I'll definitely be checking in on Assault Spy more in the future, since it shows some genuine potential and I'm interested to see if it can improve, but currently it needs some touching up. On the complete flip side of this, Luca Born of a Dream couldn't be more different from Assault Spy in this little niche genre of games, both from an aesthetic and design point of view. developed by a small team going by the name Me Less Than 3, and for transparency's sake, I will state that Codex Entry, who acted as QA and trailer editor for the team, gifted me a copy of this game. Luca is arguably the Undertale to Bayonetta's Earthbound. Not so much in the meta humor aspect, though there is a little bit of that, but more in taking a lot of what made that genre of games great, while having an extremely unique take on it. Luca throws you in headfirst into a chaotic post-apocalyptic world that is falling apart, where characters are constantly fighting to survive in this horrific existential hellscape full of monstrosities with some, let's say, strong Christian imagery. A lot of your playtime is going to be spent piecing together what has happened to this world and what your character's relation to it is, from the flavor text and notes left around and smaller set pieces in the game. Though most of it won't really click until your New Game Plus playthrough, where some of the key details come in, and makes the key promo art make a bit more sense. From that description, you might expect an indie title like Luca to be some bog-standard RPG or text adventure, but it actually bundles in Platinum Games' faster, response-heavy combat in, with some of Bloodborne's aggression-heavy mechanics and tones, and an almost Silent Hill-esque atmosphere. Earlier, I used Bayonetta as a point of comparison, which from the gameplay you can likely see where that comes from. Though it may be more accurate to compare Luca to Nier Automata, as you have both light and heavy attacks for close combat, classified as mantras, balanced with a familiar, which works similarly to the pods in Automata that are used for support and cover fire. Both your mantras and familiars can be swapped out for different ones that can be found throughout the world or purchased at shops, each with unique properties that dictate their usability in combat, from power and distance to specific buffs and special attacks. And you have two separate loadouts to swap between during combats, a la Bayonetta. So you have a lot to experiment with as you unlock more, delving into the timing and range for attack animations, and what mantras and familiars complement each other. Something to keep in mind though is that Luca uses a Souls-like stamina meter, where each attack uses a certain amount of stamina, depending on the mantra itself and whether it's a light or heavy attack. So finding a good balance for weapon loadouts can be extremely important, since draining your meter completely on huge power hits will leave you open quickly, especially if the attack doesn't break the enemy's guard and they're ready to counter. Though, while mantra attacks use stamina, hits from them fill up your charge meter, which is mainly used for your familiar as a sort of ammunition bar. So you're constantly trying to balance using both lighter and stronger attacks with cover fire from your familiar during moments while you take a sec for your stamina to recharge, then rebuilding more energy for your familiar by jumping back into combat. But all of this is just the surface level essentials to the combat. Admittedly, you aren't going to find any high times, aerial raves, or rising dragons, and it would be challenging to make some insane combo mad video from it, as the game goes for a more straightforward approach to its combat, but that doesn't mean that Luca isn't brimming with depth, boiling down a lot of the character action style of gameplay into its core elements. There's dodge mechanics, parries, mid-combo loadout switching, unique charge attacks, enemy stunning, and a couple other things I'll leave as a surprise. The game gives you a lot of tools so that you never feel completely vulnerable and always feel like you have an answer to each new enemy as long as you play it smart. Though, aside from the different mantras and familiars you can find, the thing that most significantly changes how combat works in Luca is virtues, which can trigger different mechanics or power-ups depending on which are equipped it, like adding in a witch time style slowdown after perfect dodges, or a rally mechanic like in Bloodborne where you can recover health briefly after taking damage by responding in kind, just to name a couple. However, considering how drastically some of these improve your capabilities, there is a limitation to them, as they each cost a certain amount of points, which you obviously only have a limited amount of, with the most powerful ones having a higher cost. So you have to regularly balance them based on which are more reliable to your playstyle. As you get into it, Luca drastically opens up the more you play it, as you gain more mantras, familiars, virtues, and other mechanics that all change the ways you approach combat. Possibly one of the most unique features, though, is the rewind item, which lets you reverse to the start of the fight if it isn't going well, though you have a limited amount of them per resting point. This mechanic means that making mistakes in combat aren't detrimental, since it basically gives you a manual F5 system, which helps with some of the more challenging enemy types and bosses that come up. The trade-off for this, however, is that with each death, you become more corrupted, indicated by an increasing number on the top of the screen, and if it's allowed to reach 100%, results in essentially locking you into the bad ending. So while the game is a bit more lenient when it comes to making mistakes, it balances it by adding on more pressure with a sort of ticking clock aspect, where too many frequent mistakes can result in a bad end, which can prevent you from getting the base ending of New Game and the true ending in New Game Plus. A couple of mechanics are introduced after the first playthrough that slightly alleviates this struggle, namely lowering your corruption after enemy encounters based on how well you performed, though that itself is counteracted by the fact corruption builds up over time on top of simply taking hits on these later runs, which drastically changes the difficulty of the game and essentially demands higher level play as you keep going forward. I mean, you can always lower the difficulty if you want, but who wants to do that? Now, just like with Assault Spy, while I have a lot of admiration for what Luca is doing, I do have a couple of grievances. The scratchy hand-drawn art style adds to this feeling of desperation and confusion that is thematically appropriate for what the game is going for, and makes it stand out from most others on the market, but it's a major limitation to it regardless, as it can be difficult to figure out exactly where you are or what you're looking at times, and is unfortunately going to put a lot of people off that aren't into more abstract visuals. The enemies don't feel as diverse as they could be either, since some can feel a tad samey at times, and while I do like how the game handles its weapons and how they allow for a lot of customization, some of the mantras and familiars feel kind of useless in the late game, though you could argue that that's good weapon progression. Overall though, my gripes notwithstanding, both Luca and Assault Spy are amazing games in their own rights for those that enjoy character action, hack and slash gameplay that allows for a lot of inventive combos and ways of approaching combat. These games, despite their indie qualities, show a good understanding of what makes titles like Devil May Cry, Bayonetta, or Nier Automata beloved, while adding in their own unique twists on the gameplay to make them stand out on their own, further proving that there's plenty of places for this little subgenre to go. And here's hoping that this is just the start of more games like them. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.